Okay, let's get started. And to introduce our next speaker, Wayne Simmons.
Thank you very much, Mary Lou. Our next speaker is the editor of the Financial Post. Financial Post is a part of the National Post. That's Canada's best national newspaper. There's another one out there which is not worth you buying. And Terence Corcoran, I've been reading Terence Corcoran since he was a columnist for the other newspaper back in the late 80s. One column I specifically remember, it was on the death of Frederick Hayek. And Terence Corcoran is definitely a friend of liberty. He's going to be discussing junk science in the media, and it's a definite growing concern for us all. And please put your hands together and welcome a friend of liberty, Terence Corcoran.
Thank you very much, Wayne. It's a distinct pleasure to be here amongst the people who are sympathetic to the ideas of individual freedom and whose ideological starting point is individual freedom. Now, I'm a journalist, and as Wayne mentioned, I'm editor of the Financial Post, which is the financial and business section of the National Post, which is the largest circulation national daily newspaper in Canada. You'll be, I hope, pleased to know and to learn. My role at the Post is to write editorials and to oversee the editorial page of the Financial Post. And the overall point of view of the editorial page is one of advocacy for free markets and individual liberty and persistent irreverent disdain for most forms of collectivism. Thank you. Boy, you're going to be an easy audience compared to... usually I speak to an association of grocery manufacturers, and they are actually petrified to hear what I have to say. Even though a lot of them might agree, they just don't feel it might be the right thing to do, to applaud. So thank you for that. And what I'm going to talk about today is junk science and the role of the media in promoting junk science. There's no formal structure to what I'm going to say. In sort of true journalistic form, I'm going to ramble around and present a collage of different thoughts and ideas that and impressions and observations around the general theme that junk science is one of the most pernicious forces in the world today, and the media is largely responsible for its existence. Junk science is at the core of the most peculiar and ominous political developments of our time, the escalating use of state power to enforce the alleged findings of science, no matter what the risks are, and no matter what the science, and no matter how uncertain and junky the science. Now, to understand this process, we need to have, I think, a definition of junk science. But before I get to that, let me give you a sample of junk science at work and how the media sort of gets sucked into it. And this is a story about a story in the National Post, my newspaper, a few months ago about smoking. The headline on the story was, "Non-smoking men have sex more often and enjoy it more." Now, journalists love this kind of story. It gives them an opportunity to write clever sentences. And in this story, for example, the writer begins, "The Marlboro man may be good in the saddle, but he is likely not so good in bed." Now, that's fine, and a little fun in a news story is good for everybody, I think. But then we get to some of the facts. The researchers reportedly studied 290 men between the ages of 24 and 36 to come up with this conclusion that smokers had sex less often. Worse than that, smokers didn't enjoy their sex as much as non-smokers. Now, that could have been the end of the story, except for some of the numbers. The story said, and this is a true story, by the way, I'm quoting from the story as it appeared in the newspaper. The story said smokers only had sex 6 times a week What? While non-smokers had sex 12 times a week. What's the matter with you libertarians? Anyway, but like you, I thought, on reading the story, I said, this is a lot of sex. It works out to twice a day for non-smokers, given time off to reorganize for the Sabbath, or at least to go out now and then to buy some groceries. And if that's the average, you had to figure that some men would be above the average. And the whole story just didn't make any sense. So I decided to try to find out more about this study. And what I found was that it was a study not of average men. Instead, it was a study of men enrolled with their wives in fertility programs. This is absolutely true. These were men who were trying with their spouses to have babies to create a pregnancy. Now, with that information, which was not reported in the newspaper, the story made a bit more sense. And now we can understand why smokers have less sex. After a while, having sex 12 times a week, or about twice a day, to create a baby was bound to become something more like work. And by the end of the first month, or even the first week, of this twice-a-day sex effort, the average couple would begin to suffer from sex fatigue. And for the smokers, at least, there's an alternative. No, honey, not again. Why don't we have a smoke instead, you know? The point of this is that the world of scientific research and public policy research is drowning in this kind of bizarre information that has no real relation to truth. It's a form of junk science. Now, it's easy to use the phrase junk science and apply it to anything you don't agree with, and it's sort of a loaded, pejorative phrase that makes some people uneasy. And probably there is a problem with it, but I think it's a useful concept, one that can be defined in an objective way that should be understandable and acceptable even to senior bureaucrats and scientists who are in sensitive positions in government and industry. The day when a bureaucrat can turn to a journalist and declare that the Greenpeace report on this or that hazard is based on a form of junk science, perhaps only then will the advance of good science be assured. So, junk science needs to be defined, and Elizabeth Whalen, president of the American Center of Science and Health, once defined the two key elements of junk science: the distortion of scientific fact and the exaggeration of risk. And I would take the definition just a little bit further. Junk science occurs when scientific facts are distorted, risks are exaggerated, and science is steeped in politics and ideology. I think it's important to add those points on. From this perspective, the role of the media essentially often defines junk science. Indeed, if you look at the definition, you are also looking at science journalism in action. Distorted facts, exaggerated risks, suffused with politics and ideology, these are the hallmarks of media activity. There are four or five key areas that I want to cover in looking at the role of media and risk and how it works in conjunction with risk and the media's role in reporting on risk. I'm going to give some reasons that might help explain why journalists behave the way they do. I'm going to argue that the role the media is playing is destructive and dangerous. And I'm going to briefly review two specific cases from the recent annals of junk science policy. These are Canadian examples, but the principles are the same just about everywhere. The two cases, by the way, are bovine growth hormone and soft vinyl plastic toys. We'll look at the role of the media in distorting the risks surrounding those particular products shortly. But and I'll finally end on what I hope is ultimately a bit of a positive note, and that suggests that there is some room for optimism. For the present, though, the media play a troubling and disruptive role in the presentation of health and environmental risk. Most of you are familiar with the pattern and some of the great horrors of media behavior in the past. LR in apples, the breast implant scare, cell phones as causes of cancer, the current hysteria in Britain and elsewhere over genetically modified food, otherwise known in every media report as Frankenstein food or Frankenfood. It's funny how it's unacceptable to use the phrase junk science to describe anything, but it's immediately acceptable to throw in the word Frankenfood into every news report. And it's acceptable in general public discourse. As a general statement, I think that it's accurate to say that there is no such thing as media reporting on risk. There is no evidence that the media has exercised any role in explaining, reporting, defining, identifying even the nature of risk in any meaningful or sustained way. Journalists do not report risk, they ride the wave of popular ignorance surrounding risk. Journalists are also suckers for bad science, and anybody who parades by in a lab coat carrying what looks like a relevant PhD. Newspapers, radio, television, magazines, they all lurch from story to story on cancer cures, cancer scares, the toxic chemicals, global warming alarms. In the media, all of life is surrounded by treacherous, man-made risk. Now, why do journalists behave the way they do? How do crazy, sensational exaggerations and distortions become part of the daily news flow? Well, I've got about six or seven different sort of mini explanations, each of which is part of the mix. And some of them are banal, I guess. We can start with the just utter stupidity, and this is not an impossibility since some journalists are just plain dumb. We have willful ignorance as another option. They don't know, and they don't really want to know, because it'll get in the way of a story, interfere with a good story, or interfere with the dominant ideology, which we'll come to. There's sheer lethargy and intellectual laziness. Figuring out a scientific issue as a writer or editor requires a degree of intellectual output that's seldom required in other areas of media coverage, especially politics. In politics, the elements of cause and effect are totally irrelevant. It is possible to make things up in political journalism and nobody can prove you wrong. For example, I could write 1,000 words explaining why Cheney makes an excellent vice presidential running mate for George Bush, and then you could write 1,000 words on the other hand, says he's a terrible choice. But there's no provable content to it. It's just sort of random descriptions of things that might be happening in society, but you can't prove them. There's no real content. Many journalists, if not most journalists, lack training and experience for a variety of reasons, whether they're young or old or middle-aged. They're just not trained in science, numbers, statistics. Our education system also doesn't encourage the type of thinking required to at least attempt to evaluate science stories when they happen. There's a psychological predisposition in journalists. Now, you should know that the people who go into journalism are not the type of people who spend their time looking for a cure for cancer or trying to figure out how to build a better mousetrap. The instinct of the journalist, the mindset of the journalist, is to stand around the water cooler and ask questions. Why hasn't somebody else found a cure for cancer yet? Or they might say, well, it might be a better mousetrap, but do we really need it, and is it safe? That's the starting point for the journalist. Journalists, as a rule, are not original thinkers. They are idea borrowers, idea transmitters, and idea processors. This has a profound impact on the products of journalism. We are totally dependent for a variety of reasons, including journalistic methods, especially in the daily newspapers and on daily television reporting, totally dependent on other people for what we do. And because of that, journalists and the media are easily manipulated. Journalists also have a love-hate relationship with change. Mostly, they are mesmerized by anything that upsets the status quo. A plane crash upsets the status quo, and you can become totally obsessed with that unnerving event. Anybody who spent time in newsrooms over the last 20 years and witnessed the introduction of computers to replace typewriters and paper will know that journalists were dragged kicking and screaming into the digital age. The computers won't work, they're going to destroy creativity, the quality of journalism and writing is going to go down. Deadlines will be forced to be so early we'll never be able to get our stories in any timely fashion. Every one of these fears has proved false, and in fact, as any writer went through that will tell you, it's a fabulous bonanza for writers to have access to computer technology and electronic and typesetting, all that type of wonderful technology. Now, journalists always pretend to be at the forefront of change in technology, which in a way they are, but mostly as scaremongers. Journalists are in a constant state of agitation over anything that alters, as I said, the current world. Most of the headlines on most of the newspapers over the last 100 years could probably be paraphrased accurately into a couple of generic statements: terrible change grips nation. Or, if it isn't happening yet, terrible change looms on the horizon. Another thought on journalists and the nature of media behavior, in some ways I shouldn't be saying these things, but they have occurred to me as probable or possible causes. There's a certain malevolence and demagoguery involved in being a journalist. There's a certain sense of almost evil power that comes from standing in front of a camera or writing a front page story or even writing a column telling people at home that the plastic bottle their baby is nursing from could kill the baby. Or that some other mundane part of our daily lives, power fields around electric appliances or cell phones or whatever, could cause brain cancer. Journalism practices and routines are also a factor. Deadlines, the rush to print, and the need to grab readers and boost ratings and sell more newspapers, all these things you are, I'm sure, familiar with are drivers of media performance and the attitudes that they bring toward changing circumstances and toward scientific issues. And then we have ideology. The majority of news reporters and editors, whether they are lazy or malevolent or not, the majority are on the left side of the spectrum. They are anti-business, anti-industry, opposed to markets, and are greatly suspicious of individual freedom, with the exception of freedom of the press and the freedom of journalists. Journalists support the regulation of just about everything except journalism. It's simply part of the ideology. Journalists are generally predisposed to government regulation and government solutions to all problems, and this is where we get to the rise of junk science. Over the last two decades, few things have inspired greater media agitation for government action than the products of junk science. None of this media activity would amount to much in isolation if the product of journalism were not incorporated into the political process. There would be very little to worry about, except perhaps the sanity of journalists. But politicians and bureaucrats react to a general political atmosphere created by, in large part, the media and perceived through the process of the media's transmission mechanisms. Now, there are some who argue that the role of the media is simply that of a participant in a larger change in society, a change in attitude toward risk. They see the media as a catalyst in a process by which society at large changes, its perception of what is dangerous and what is risky. Now, some have called this process the democratization of risk. When a television news reports on the dangers to children of a certain kind of vinyl plastic baby bottle, it may be simply helping to redefine the standards of risk that are acceptable to society at large. New risk standards are being set, and the media, under this argument, are helping the public at large define what those new, more rigid standards are. Governments then move in and enforce this new higher standard. The phrase democratization of risk, which some have called this process, is, however, far from a benign concept. It is really the collectivization of risk, the compulsory collectivization of risk. It is more accurate to talk about the collectivization of risk because the objective here is to impose one perspective of risk on the entire population or on huge segments of the population. Today, as a result of the media working in conjunction with various interest groups, we are moving toward new concepts of risk and new collective definitions of risk. We no longer accept risk that would have been taken for granted years ago. Electric wiring in homes is much safer than it was 50 years ago or 25 years ago or 10 years ago. In fact, thousands of products and services are now less risky than they used to be. Just about all of the risk reduction, however, came about without regulation and even without any general collective awareness of risk or even the concept of risk. We simply didn't need to know. But the collectivization of risk is just the beginning. With the help of the media, we are no longer simply dealing with sort of new improved levels, new standards of risk tolerance. We're now talking about zero risk tolerance. Although it's even worse than that. Recent experience suggests we are now, or entering, if we're not in it already, a regulatory zone that is even more extreme. Of the two regulatory cases I mentioned earlier, two recent Canadian junk science cases, bovine hormone and vinyl plastic toys, we move toward an even more severe definition of risk, not just zero risk, but something even greater beyond zero risk. This collectivization of risk is getting us off on a dramatic departure from the past. In the past, we have made progress in reducing risk. Today, risk reduction is often stalled. Because of the media and the environmental groups, new levels of risk tolerance are being set that are unreal. Changes in products and services that actually would reduce risk, the use of plastics in bottles and intravenous bags and toys, biotechnology, genetically modified foods, are now being blocked in the name of other risks that don't exist beyond something at zero. The Greenpeace campaign against vinyl plastic is legendary. They have tried to get plastic plumbing banned on the claim that polyvinyl chloride pipes leach dangerous toxins into the water system. They're trying to force companies and governments to ban the hospital use of intravenous plastic bags. The Greenpeace campaign against plastic toys has brought Canada to the brink of the zero-risk tolerance plateau and out into the absurd territory beyond zero. And the media has played right into the campaign. Early last winter, with Greenpeace launching ad campaigns in the New York Times and elsewhere, and ready to start a campaign in Canada, the media was set to pounce. The Government of Canada issued a health warning advising parents to dispose of soft vinyl products that small children might put in their mouths. Health Canada, which is the national monitor of product safety, said that, and this is a quote, "There are scientific indications of a potential health risk for very young children who have high oral contact with soft vinyl products." As a result of the warning, the plastics industry, for a whole bunch of complicated reasons are due to its own particular circumstances in Canada, the plastics industry removed all vinyl toys from toy stores that contained a certain kind of plastic. At the time of the warning, I called up Health Canada and I asked the bureaucrat there, exactly what are the scientific indications of a potential health risk? What are the chances of a baby suffering adverse health effects? Well, said the bureaucrat, less than one in a million. There are only 20 million people in 30 million people in Canada. And that one in a million chance would only arise if a baby spent 3 hours a day, 7 days a week, over a period of years, with a soft vinyl product in its mouth. Now, no media reported this. It was taken for granted that the toys were dangerous. And this was just before Christmas, actually. And you can imagine the headlines and big flap and the toys, millions of dollars worth of toys were taken off the market. And that's junk science in action. It easily fits the definition of exaggerated risk, distorted facts, steeped in politics and ideology. With the media as cheerleader, the government of Canada had toy retailers remove millions of dollars in plastic teethers, rattlers from shops. And with that, Health Canada is sort of in this zone of beyond zero risk tolerance. We have a story, we have a pressure group, we have some vague or some remote statistical risk, and the products are pulled. Now, this same standard of risk, beyond zero, was applied in the second case, the Canadian government's decision to continue a ban that existed on the use of bovine growth hormone, BST, by Canadian dairy farmers. Now, here the media was even more culpable, in my opinion. Bovine growth hormone, BST, for those of you who might not be farmers, and I'm not a farmer, so I don't even know what I'm talking about, is injected into cattle to increase milk production. It's widely used across the United States. But in Canada, it became part of a political process that engulfed Canadian media, politicians, bureaucrats, industry executives, and the usual group of environmental and health activists. Health Canada decided to maintain its ban, existing ban on the use of the hormone, after a group of rebel scientists within Health Canada created a public furor in the media and in the Senate. They were aided by a group called the Council of Canadians, a nationalist interest group with Ralph Nader connections and enthusiasms. Along with other health groups, they became obsessed with the idea that BST fed to cows creates a human health hazard or risk that would be passed on to humans through milk. In the course of a major public confrontation, the media consistently followed the line of the rebel scientists who claimed BST is a health hazard to humans and that further tests were required to fill what they kept referring to as gaps in the research. There are a lot of complicated issues within Health Canada as background to this, which I'm going to spare you. But to resolve the conflict, supposedly, the government commissioned an objective outside scientific study. I'm going to quote from the study, which found that there was no measurable human risk involved in Canadian farmers using the hormone. The scientists who led the research team, Dr. Stuart McLeod of McMaster University, called BST risks to human health. This was a sophisticated scientific study. He said that the risk to human health was infinitesimal, which is about as close as you can get to zero. Milk from BST-treated cows is indistinguishable from non-treated cows. On another issue, the impact of insulin-like growth factor, which was another scientific concern, Dr. McLeod said it was biologically implausible that a risk could be created. Again, this is closest to a zero-risk conclusion as you can get from a scientist who will never tell you that there is no risk. But when Dr. McLeod issued his report last January, the media barely mentioned his conclusions. After months of promoting the idea that BST was a health risk, the media ignored his conclusions completely. Instead, the media focused on another animal's health study, which said there were impacts on BST-treated cows. These are physical impacts related to certain kinds of infections, impacts that are routinely treated in the United States, just as a matter of daily routine in the farming business. On the basis of the animal study, they decided to maintain the ban, regardless of the fact that there was no human impact. Over in the Senate, meanwhile, because this isn't the end of it, one of the centers continued to wage a campaign to turn BST into a human health hazard. A Senate committee, in effect, said it was not satisfied with virtually zero risk. In an interim report, BST report, the Senate proposed redefining Canada's standards of risk assessment that would essentially require research to be conducted into all aspects of BST to satisfy every scientific objection raised by any scientist they happen to find. This standard is essentially a beyond zero risk standard, and the Senate committee wanted to incorporate it as Health Canada's operating principle. This is an application of an extreme precautionary principle, an application that is run amok. We're not looking at whether there is a health risk as determined by science. We are looking for something beyond risks, some political objective that cannot quite be defined and is never really clearly defined. And that means that to achieve that end, the media is brought in through the vehicle of junk science. Now, I've only got a few more points to make, and I'm going to try to, after all that grim stuff, end somewhat optimistically. A lot of damage can and will be done by the media and the process that creates the conditions for junk science. But there are occasional signs that some journalists are growing more skeptical of routine scientific reports of the type that make headlines every day. When the Journal of the American Medical Association recently published a Toronto hospital study that concluded that pregnant women exposed to solvents and chemicals at work have greater risk of giving birth to babies with birth defects, Canadian television and newspapers reported it straight. The National Post, my newspaper, put it on the front page. It dominated the television news shows that night with pictures of hairdressers, graphic artists, and a range of other professions interviewed and portrayed who were said to be at risk of having deformed babies. The New York Times, however, quoted other scientists who said the study was far from conclusive. The New York Times went out and interviewed other scientists who were familiar with the field, and they found, these other scientists said, that there were about a dozen flaws in the study. The women studied were not randomly selected. There were many potential confounders, and the evidence was based on self-reporting. There was a whole series of problems with the original study. One of the scientists, critical of the study, said, "Think of all the women of childbearing age who will be scared to death." Now, after my review of the journalist, you'll realize that there's not a lot of thought given to that subject in most of the television and news rooms of the major media. And this is, unfortunately, a rare example of at least one attempt to put science and risk in perspective. It's a little bit of a sort of calm rationality in a daily blizzard of risk, distortion, and information. Type of stuff we get every day. But on a final note of, I hope, optimism, and this is ideological optimism in a way, over the long term, I do believe that markets work, and the media are part of a complicated free market and ideas that still, for the most part, exists in this country and in America and many parts of the world. And the end of that free market process, the truth will triumph, and ultimately, good science will prevail over junk science. Thank you very much.
Okay, we have about 8 minutes for questions. Ben, who's got the mics? Ben.
Hello, testing. Hey, I'm a bit nervous with the microphone, but it's sort of an open question here. I think a reason people put up with substandard newspapers, like junk science, is because they don't have a good alternative. And like just lately, I've found a lot of good alternatives on the internet. Like instead of having my breakfast and reading bad newspapers, I get the Daily Mail out from, I think it's the Advocates for Self-Government, and I read Sarah's TCS discussion group. So I just have a question for everyone that you could answer maybe afterwards, just to me personally, just if you can tell me any other good discussion groups or internet things that go on every day.
I'm the wrong person to ask that question of.
Well, just tell him to look for your column on the internet.
Yes, you can reread that. Wait, why don't you?
Just look for Terry's column, George Jonas, Karen Selleck, John Chabrol. There are a number of columnists for the National Post and other newspapers that you should search for on the internet, too.
But do you want to get other people to?
Not now.
Sorry,
Jim, please. Thanks, Ben.
First of all, I'd like to thank you for a very interesting talk. I teach a course in engineering at the University of Virginia where I introduce students to various notions of risk. Just a comment. It's quite possible that good science may actually triumph, but it won't necessarily matter because, of course, the consumers of that good science may not they may have a very unrealistic notion of what risk actually is. And so it's quite possible that even if the market mechanism works well, if people are not, in a sense, educated as to the appropriate standards of what risk is, it may not matter.
That's possible, although I do think that a lot of people do have an innate sense of what of the risks that they're dealing with, depending on different things that they're doing. Even though a plane crashes, within an hour, everybody piles right onto the plane, even though they are horrified and believe there should be massive regulation of airline travel, they will still jump onto the next plane. So there's a there is a process by which people do make their own risk assessments. And I suspect individual choice risk assessments are much more effective. The problem is the regulation that gets piled up outside of the individual risk.
Chris. Hi, my name's Chris Essex. I'm a scientist and a mathematician. I'm in the office next door here. This whole issue of junk science is something that I am very familiar with. It's something that's a great irritation for me often to see what's going on. You mentioned some topics such as global warming, for example. Something I know a fair amount about. One of the things I would add to your list of things that define junk science or characterize it is something I call a runaway metaphor. It's, in journalism, it seems that when you're trying to explain an idea, a metaphor becomes a very useful thing. But eventually the metaphor becomes a kind of a monster. It actually takes over the science and the truth of the matter. And I can give you some simple examples. Some of them, in fact, are so ingrained in how people think about things, you'd probably be surprised when I say it. One of the sort of inside jokes among people who work in radiative transfer is that greenhouses don't work by the greenhouse effect. Sorry, it just doesn't work that way. The ozone hole is not a hole. Sorry, it's just, you might think, maybe it's just misinforming people to some extent. But there's another sort of aspect of it, and that is because science has become so compartmentalized itself, what happens is a lot of people in one compartment learn about what's going on in another compartment by reading the newspapers. And so the result is that a lot of research starts spinning off in some kind of strange directions precisely because of these kinds of junk science type things going on. And they start producing research that sort of fits into the dynamics of this stuff. And so then it actually starts, the whole process starts going off in some weird direction.
Another sort of element of that is that there are a number of scientists who, I don't know enough about science to say that they're bad scientists, but they who have either ideological bents of their own that shapes their science, or there are, my suspicion is, there is a teaching of science that allows certain principles to get through in epidemiology, for example, where there is no cause and effect, but you have statistical relationships and you can sort of take huge jumps forward. Now this, which in turn feeds back to the media, so when you have something like the ozone hole, I doubt that it's a journalist who dreamt that up. It might be somebody at NASA, it might be a scientist somewhere. There's a whole community of scientists who, because of the way journalists operate, become creators of junk science and feed it to the journalists who are always looking for another side. If you say there's no problem with global warming, the way... if you had said that, let's say, a journalist, by virtue of their training and the way the newspapers and television operates, well, we got to find another guy who says that's not true, just as a matter of routine. So there's a whole community of scientists there as well.
The point is that the cliche begins to take over.
Yes, I agree. I'm just trying to defend journalists, saying that it's probably journalists that not necessarily a journalist who created the cliche, would be my...
No, but the whole thing is the process that we're all sort of out of control.
Yes, I get your point. Thank you.
Okay, two more quick ones. Sorry, I know everybody wants to talk, and I'm sorry, Mark. Richard, you could be short if you can, please.
Yeah. It's quite clear that pollution in the 19th century limited the life expectancy to around 45 years, and that in the 20th century it jumped by about that amount by improvements in primarily in pollution. When I tell this to people who are under 50 and not in this group, I find that very few people will even consider it. I have a distinguished organic chemist who should understand pollution who claims, well, what about CO2, what about ozone, the ozone hole that you mentioned. And I consider these are almost non-contenders. I also know that, for example, Ben Bradley on the McNeil Air Report declared that the newspaper had complete faith in groups like Greenpeace because they're unbiased. And I'm concerned about what rewrite editors do to articles done by reporters who have talked to the...
Yeah, I don't think that the rewrite editors are responsible. I mean, it's a newspaper or any media is a very complicated collection of people who are to some degree individualists in terms of what they're up to and what they think is important. They don't all think identically as a herd at any one point in time, except in sort of a broad sense. When it comes to individual stories, there are battles, there are fights, there are disagreements. An editor can have zero impact, so it wouldn't be, that would not be a cause of whatever problems one might find in a newspaper.
Okay, one last question for this session.
I also have a presence on a university campus in chemistry department, and my sense is also, like this gentleman over here, that there's a lot of pernicious misinformation about science that some of which has persisted for thousands of years. And I'm very doubtful that it will disappear. As an example, momentum is not well understood by a lot of people. Otherwise, everyone would wear a seatbelt. And the only way that this information will be eradicated, this misinformation will be eradicated, is through fatal collisions. So I'm not too hopeful. I wish I could be more hopeful about the ultimate prevailing of good science, because I think it would give us in the libertarian movement some hope too that good politics will prevail. But in the meantime, in the meantime, I have a question for you, and that is, until good science does prevail, why doesn't the media resort to second and third sources? I mean, why aren't stories checked out with perhaps opposing viewpoints?
Oh, I think, well, a lot of them are, and I think. There's a tendency it's so hard to generalize. If anything, that is part of the problem with the media, I think, is that they're constantly going for the other side. So if somebody comes out and says, citing the example, if a scientist would come out and said that the ozone hole is not a problem, a journalist is going to say, I don't really think that's necessarily true, but I'm going to go find somebody who will say that it's not probably not true. So there's this automatic attempt to get a second source or to balance off an opinion is, to my mind, a bit of the cause of the problem, because it puts journalists at the mercy of whoever they happen to contact. They report things that they're told. I don't think I'm quite answering your question, but I'm running out of time to think about it.
I can help you. Just as a suggestion, just make sure that you get on the list to be contacted as a second source. And that's another strategy we'll talk about later. Yeah. Okay, I want to thank you very much, Terry.